Welcome back to Nature League. It's the second week of the month, and that means it is time for a field trip. So this month is all about invertebrates, and we are right here at Flathead Lake to check out all the really fascinating issues, all of the storylines, all the histories and biodiversity of invertebrates right here in our local system. We actually have a biological station that is connected to the University of Montana where I go to school. And so we are gonna be able to be here with experts and actually go out and check out some of this on the lake. And lucky for us, we actually have the director of the biological station here with us to be our field guide. This is Dr. Jim Elser.
Great to be here. We're gonna see a lot of zooplankton tonight.
Let's do it, rock and roll. In terms of surface area, Flathead Lake is the largest U.S. freshwater lake west of the Mississippi River. It has its own stunning beauty and many stories to tell. I decided to visit Flathead Lake for our Invertebrate Month here on Nature League because one of these incredible stories involves an invertebrate, the Mysis shrimp. Flathead Lake was a chunk of ice until about 15 to 20,000 years ago. In the late 1800s, accounts of Flathead Lake detailed about 10 species of fish. So at this point, fisheries managers saw an opportunity to stock Flathead Lake with a ton of fish that the public would enjoy fishing and eating. State and federal managers intentionally introduced about 25 fish species into the lake. One of these was the kokanee salmon, and people absolutely loved fishing and eating them. That meant major money for the local economy, so fishery managers were like, we should make sure that the kokanee have plenty of food. They introduced what they thought would be a better food, the larger freshwater shrimp Mysis. What happened over the next few years has become one of the most famous examples of a trophic cascade ever recorded. Between 1984 and 1989, kokanee and Flathead Lake went from over 300,000 individuals to zero. See, the Mysis shrimp eat zooplankton, which are also invertebrates, but much smaller than the Mysis. These zooplankton were the original food for the kokanee, so the Mysis started directly competing with the kokanee for food. The kokanee couldn't even eat the Mysis because Mysis hang out on the lake bottom during the day while kokanee feed near the surface. However, the introduced lake trout and lake whitefish feed on the bottom. Hello, Mysis shrimp. Instead of the preferred kokanee salmon eating the Mysis, the introduced lake trout and whitefish had an everyday buffet. Their population skyrocketed while kokanee disappeared. Fast forward to today, and Flathead Lake is dominated by three species introduced by humans: lake trout, lake whitefish, and Mysis shrimp. But the coolest part, in my opinion, is that researchers at the Flathead Lake Biological Station were able to monitor and study this entire process and are still actively monitoring Mysis shrimp and other invertebrates today. For this field trip, we joined a crew for late night invertebrate sampling on Flathead Lake. But first, a word. Not from our sponsors, but from the dictionary. Welcome to this month's Wild Word. Once a month on Nature League, we'll look at the etymology, or origin and history, of words related to nature. This month's theme is invertebrates, so we're gonna examine a word that is used when talking about the most specious group of invertebrates. The word is insect. Like our other wild words on Nature League, the word insect is a pretty common word. However, a true breakdown of the word helps inform us about the group of animals it describes. You may have heard before that the sect part of insect derives from a root word meaning six. And that seems to make sense because we think of insects as things with six legs. However, this isn't exactly correct. The word insect can actually be traced back to something a little bit different. Insect comes to us from Latin and can be split into two parts. The prefix in is a Latin word meaning into. So far, so good. But what about the sect part of the word insect? It's actually from a noun form of the Latin verb sectare, which means to cut. This is really straightforward word-wise, but in my opinion, the elegance is in how perfectly this denotation fits these organisms. I mean, just look at them! As biologists long ago started using this term to describe this group of organisms, they were definitely recognizing that this was a unique body plan, unlike anything else on Earth. So while a formal definition of insect is any of a class of arthropods with well-defined head, thorax, and abdomen, only three pairs of legs, and typically one or two pairs of wings, insect literally means to cut into. Nothing like being named after what you look like, right? Though insects do in fact have many different defining traits, it's undeniable that they look cut into. Literally, they look insected. And that is pretty wild. The Mysis shrimp do a vertical migration daily when they feed, so we had to wait until it was pitch dark for them to come up from the bottom. This meant timing our trip for the new moon and waiting to sample until late that night. We sampled at three different depths using a tow net. We used a red light, which is invisible to the Mysis shrimp, but let us see what we were doing. At each depth, we took three different tow samples and filtered them down into falcon tubes to take back to the lab. The next morning, we sat down with Jim Elser to chat about the sampling we did, as well as the biostation itself.
A biological station is essentially like a super collider is for physicists. It's a facility for research discovery and learning. In the wilds often, sometimes in the fringe lands, sometimes in farmlands, but it's where biological, ecological processes take place, and you can study organisms, ecosystems more easily, you know, and experiment in them in ways you just can't possibly do when you're, you know, on campus or in a city.
With Mysis, even though that's not like your personal project, that is a definite personal project for Flathead Lake. And so what's the sitch on Mysis?
Mysis is a, you know, when it's an adult about that big, we saw them last night in our samples, it's a malacostracan. It's related to lobsters and crabs and krill. If you look at it, it looks like a krill. Common name is opossum shrimp. The biological station was here. It's been here since 1899, and the scientists were sampling the lake. They started to sample for Mysis before they arrived, actually. It just goes to show how important it is to monitor ecosystems, especially valuable ones like this one. So our scientists sample this lake for all kinds of things. Year-round, around a very regular basis, using very standard methods so we can see what's happening.
Right, and monitoring, again, in situ, on site, is one of the coolest things that you get from having something like a biological station. So
that's right.
We should totally check out all the little guys that we found last night.
Absolutely, I think it's gonna be fun.
Then we got to check out some of our water samples under the microscope. We saw all kinds of zooplankton, as well as Mysis. It's no wonder fisheries managers thought Mysis would be better food for the kokanee. These shrimp are massive compared to the other zooplankton.
Opossum shrimp, those are the eyes. And these ones with the short antennae are cyclopoid copepods. They're another crustacean. The tiny little filaments that we see are the diatoms. Another thing you can notice while they're swimming is how jelly-like everything is when they go past. It's because it's a small spatial scale, the viscous properties of water dominate. And so these things are like living in a swimming pool of
Hydrogen bonding, like.
Well, no, it's like you were swimming in a swimming pool of molasses.
Oh, sure.
It's similar to if you were in molasses, what they experience.
The story of Mysis shrimp affecting an entire ecosystem is just one example of how tiny invertebrates can have massive effects. Places like the Flathead Lake Biological Station are monitoring these effects and discovering new things all the time. Flathead Lake is an amazing place to visit and ridiculously beautiful on the surface. But what's even cooler are all of the stories unfolding underneath. Thanks for joining us on this Nature League field trip. If you'd like to learn more about the trophic cascades and community interactions of Mysis shrimp and Flathead Lake, you can click on the links in the description below. We'll see you next week for an episode of Denatured, where I'll break down a study about another vertically migrating shrimp and how that might have an effect on the mixing of the oceans.